Welcome to part 2. In the previous video, I've introduced the project goals and desoldered the water pipe from our donor heatsink. A quick test fit showed that there are two usable spots for the water pipe to be soldered onto the other laptop's heatsink. Unfortunately, both of them were not optimal. One had really good contact to the heatsink, but the connectors ended up in a very unfortunate position, blocking the HDMI and USB-C port. And the other had a lot worse contact to the heatsink, reducing its cooling capabilities, but the connectors were in a way better position. One way or the other, the final solution wouldn't look as clean as I like, and come with major trade-offs. That's why I decided to use the desoldered water pipe for first quick proof of concept to get some baseline data. And in the next video, I want to create my own custom water pipe with more contact area, better connector positioning, and the very same quick release connectors as used with the existing water pipe. For this first baseline test in this video, I chose the water pipe's mounting position with the most contact area, of course, ignoring the problems with the connectors on the outside. So, if you have bet on the first option in the last video, you were right. Before I could start to solder in the water pipe, I had to remove the stickers and glue. Otherwise, they would melt, smell, and leave ugly residues. To remove the glue residues, I have used isopropyl alcohol and some cotton sticks. And in the end, I had to clean off some of the corrosion to make sure the solder sticks properly on the surface. I have read that acid is able to clean up copper corrosion easily. And yes, it does. In fact, also very, very fast. Of course, it makes no sense to clean the whole heatsink before the actual soldering. The heatsink will get dirty and corroded all over again anyway. But to be honest, it was really satisfying to see it fade to pure copper again. Okay, so let's start with the most critical part, the soldering. At first, I laid down the water pipe on the heatsink and adjusted its position until the contact area and the connector's position was good. As you can see, I have removed the bottom case because its framing would prevent to lay down the water pipe flat on the heatsink. So I have to make some cutouts afterwards, unfortunately. Now, after positioning the water pipe, I scratched some markings into the heatsink and applied the low temperature solder paste, which is made out of tin and bismuth as mentioned in the previous video. After that, I fixed the water pipe into place with some heat resistant clamps. And because the whole heatsink is soldered with low temperature solder, I had to fix down every other element which should not fall off or change positions, so basically everything. I had barely enough clamps to properly secure the elements, so I used some aluminium foil, pushed it into the gaps to reduce the risk of moving heat pipes. The actual soldering was mainly done using my hot plate. Again, I have installed a thermocouple to check if I'm close to the melting temperature. To make sure the solder melted properly, even at the edges of the hot plate, I assisted the melting process using my hot air station in the end of the process. After everything looked properly melted, I cut the power and cooled down the heatsink quickly using a table fan. This way you can reduce the risk of damaging the heat pipes. The result is exactly what I have hoped for. The solder joints look clean and make a wide contact to transfer a lot of heat into the water pipe. It was time to install the modded water-cooled heatsink into the laptop. To prevent cutting parts off the original bottom case, I thought that an open frame assembly might be a good idea. So, I designed a 3D printed part to hold the CPU fan without the case. and also a little reinforcement bar and stand to make sure I can put the halfway opened laptop on the table anyway. The water cooling unit I wanted to use is the XMG Oasis. Unfortunately though, I have not taken the software into the equation. The unit can only be controlled via Bluetooth using the Control Center app for a specific laptop. But of course, my laptop is not supported. So I have to work on a proper solution and show it in another video. But we need a working solution right now. Luckily, XMG had a little present for me. They gave me this. It is a prototype for the external water cooling unit, which is built with desktop grade parts by XMG together with Igor from Igor's lab. They gave it the lovely name Frankenstein. Even if it does look a little fishy, it works quite well. You simply plug in a 12-volt power source and you can decide between three different speeds for the fan and pump. Using Frankenstein, you will not see comparable results to the XMG Oasis water cooling unit, of course. But it is a good way to get some baseline results in this video. Finally, let's come to the plots. I've always done the first one without water cooling, using the air cooling and the laptop's performance mode only. And the second one was with water cooling switched on after roughly 3 minutes. As you can see, the CPU and GPU temperature drops quickly until it reaches another plateau area. You can say that the water cooling is basically adding some more cooling performance on top of the air cooling. Overall, the difference seen here is 10 degrees C for the CPU and only 6 degrees C for the GPU, unfortunately. Additionally, I have done a third one, which is shown in gray, with water cooling and the fans being locked at their idle speeds. This time, the temperature difference was a lot bigger, because the higher the temperatures, the easier it is to cut off some degrees. There was a 15 degrees C difference for the CPU and GPU. So, in the more extreme scenarios, there's a much bigger benefit. However, it was this moment I realized that the temperatures using air only did look suspiciously low for this laptop. The reason must be the open frame assembly, which does allow the air to travel into the fans more freely without the drag introduced by the laptop's case and backlit. This is often true in many laptop's case designs, but I can't recommend to add cutouts to the lid anyway. The air path is usually designed in a way the air needs to pass some passively cooled components on the mainboard, which could overheat otherwise. So you might gain some degrees for your GPU and CPU, but your laptop might die anyway because some other components overheats all the time. And there are a lot of potential heat sources on a PCB. So it might be bad case design or intentional, but whatever it is, when I want to show you real comparable results, I have to modify the case and close it up again. Adding the cutouts is pretty straightforward again. First, I mark the spots that need to be removed, and then I use my Dremel to get rid of the excessive material. The backlit, on the other hand, is a bit more difficult. To prevent cutting into it blindly, I took a photo from the assembly from the top, imported it into my CAD software and made a dummy 3D printed part, which includes the outlines and also encourages the slide to open design of the backlit. finally, properly closed, I rerun the benchmarks and got some new results using Frankenstein. This time I will show you three different benchmarks, namely Cyberpunk 2077, Cinebench R23 and the TimeSpy loop test. Cyberpunk does show the worst case nicely, because both the CPU and GPU got a very high load and put the most amount of heat into the heatsink at the same time. The overall difference was 16 degrees C for the CPU and 13 degrees C for the GPU. This way you can clearly see how much the laptop struggles to get rid of the heat when the whole case is installed. Lower temperatures do also lead to less thermal throttling. This way we can see higher clock speeds and performance. Cinebench R23 does represent CPU heavy loads nicely. As you can see, the temperature and performance benefits from the water cooling heavily. And finally, the 20 minutes TimeSpy loop test is one of the more GPU heavy loads, of course. Even if the contact area to the GPU heat pipes is very small in our case, we can see a 10 degrees C temperature difference and 2% more performance just from better cooling. And lastly, I want to note that the whole mainboard does benefit from the improved cooling performance too. You must know that in this laptop the video memory VRM is not cooled by a heatsink and can dissipate its heat through the board's copper only. As you can see, the cooling improved so much that even components on the mainboard itself are exposed to less heat. So that's it for this video. I think the efforts using the existing water pipe as seen in this video demonstrates the great potential of water-cooled laptops and make me wonder how much I might be able to improve that even further with a custom water pipe, which includes even more contact area. I will start working on that right now, and I think there's nothing more to say than thanks for watching and see you in the next one. Bye!